a lot for having me here.
Gauti Eggertsson.
I'm going to face with a couple of my students. So I'm a little bit here outside of my natural habitat. I think this is actually the first paper I've ever written that doesn't have monetary policy in it or interest rates, nominal interest rates. So what is this paper about? Well, it did actually start because we were working on stuff related to monetary policy, and maybe it's useful to motivate it that way, sort of how we started working on it. So, and this was sort of 2014, so we were working on papers that were trying to take account of the fact that we have seen over the last 30 years or so gradual decrease in real interest rates, going for, you know, order of 3 or 4 to about, depending on who you ask, between 1, let's say, 1 or even 0. So there has been a, you know, in the data, a gradual fall in the real interest rate, and by most accounts, most forecasts suggest that it's a permanent one. So what we were doing, we were writing models that were trying to rationalize this. In particular, we were writing computational OLG models with, you know, 60 generations, and, you know, putting all the bells and whistles there and trying to quantify this and explain what accounts for this. But there was just a persistent problem that we ran into when you have a gradual decline in the real interest rate, is that you start seeing a explosion in investment. Just to equate the marginal return on capital, the real interest rate is going very low, you need a very strong increase in investment. So, you know, in footnote 56, deeply buried in the paper, you know, we say, well, actually, coincident with this fall in interest rate, we assume that there is a gradual increase in markups. Okay, and that sort of solved that little problem for us. But then we sort of noticed that this is a few years ago that you know, this little dirty little modeling trick of ours that made the model sing seemed to be connected with a large literature that was emerging, looking more at the micro evidence. Suggesting that there seemed to have been some increase in markup. Many of you that are here, of course, contributed to that literature. So at that point, I guess, we decided that to elevate the footnote into something more and explain why it was that in sort of macro model we were working with, and actually most standard macro models, if you want to rationalize broad movements in some aggregate variables over the last 30 years or so, this is one trick, or this is one force, that is quite helpful. So I guess one way of looking at this paper is that it's sort of a complementary macro evidence that, you know, there seems to be something going on that is consistent with markups rising. Now, you could, of course, say, well, I don't think it's markup, and, you know, this is still a debate going strong in the literature where there has, in fact, been an increase. But I guess the macro data then seems to suggest that you need then something else to account for these things. So I thought I would start this paper here by showing you what we're going to call in the grand tradition of macroeconomics puzzles, something that is not consistent with any classical growth model, right? When you look at the data, okay? And then once I've shown you these puzzles
and explained to you why they're puzzles within the context of neoclassical growth model, I'm going to suggest to you that, you know, a secular decline in interest rate and rise in markups are going to rationalize them, okay, or solve, if you will,
the puzzles. And the main exercise in the paper is then going to be, I'm going to show you the puzzles in the data, and there's going to be nothing new in the data work. We're just going to take work from others and replicate it. So what the paper is then going to do is to show you first analytically how, you know, a gradual decline in interest rate and rise in markups can both solve these puzzles. But then, you know, the main exercise is then to do it quantitatively. Okay, so we're going to take a standard business cycle model, and we're going to add some minor additions that allow us to, you know, incorporate rise in markups. And we're going to want this model also to speak to asset prices, because some of these puzzles relate to asset prices. So we're going to have outstanding preferences, and we're going to try to, you know, price risk in a way that is consistent with sort of the modern literature. Okay, so that's sort of the broad plan. So puzzles,
qualitative solutions, quantitative exploration. Okay, so let me start then with the five puzzles. So the first one is to paraphrase Piketty, wealth is stacked. I say paraphrase Piketty because he said, you know, as you may know,
capital is back.
But when he talks about capital, he really means
what I guess I call wealth, because if you look at...
So wealth indeed, so this is wealth from the Piketty-Sias-Sukman as a ratio of output. Over the last 30 years or so, you have indeed, for 35 years,
you have seen it going from about 2.5
to close to 4. Okay?
But it's not really, it's wealth, it's not really capital. Right? Capital over output, so capital here is being computed by the perpetual inventory method by BEA.
Capital output ratio stayed roughly constant. Okay? So I guess, I suppose it's not too surprising that these two are different.
After all, in wealth, there's land, there are all sorts of things.
But I guess the thing is that the puzzle is not so much that they're different, but that this
this divergence has been increasing
over time. Okay, so in the neoclassical
growth model, of course, they should be one and the same. Okay, so that's our puzzle number one.
Okay. So, you know, there's been an increase in wealth that is not embodied in the capital stock.
Go ahead.
But that's because you're thinking like a narrow definition of capital, right? If I include intangible capital and all sorts of other forms of capital, probably the distinction
of the Yeah, of course. So what we are in fact going to do here then is that we're going to include in the definition of wealth, we're going to extend the model to account for claims and profits.
Okay.
And that's going to be, you know, you're already on to the solution to the puzzle. There's a second thing you mentioned, though, which is intangible capital, which is also could be one explanation. And I suppose we have sort of two things to say about that. One is that the story, so first of all, if you look at, say, the measures that Prescott and McGrathen have computed of intangible capital, it's just not enough to generate this, okay?
Quantitatively, okay? That's number one. But number two, if you think about intangible capital in the way a lot of people describe it, and now I'm speaking,
now I'm going to horrify, I guess, the IO crowd here. To me, when people talk about intangible capital, it sounds an awful lot to me like stuff that is quite related to increasing market power, right? Stuff that, you know, make people desire a certain good more than others, that people then attribute. I'm not going to have anything to say about that, but that seems like an interesting also avenue. But the big point, I suppose, is the...
Oh, before you go on, can you tell us what's included in the red line?
So the red line is just the BEA measure of the capital stock over output.
Well,
okay.
Take one, peel the engine one layer. Does it include residential?
So this figure actually does, and also the wealth. But one of the things that we have done, and of course this was something that people have asked us about, because our model is not going to include residential housing. So what we have done now is actually,
and I think I have the figure on slide 54 or something, where we have peeled that out of both measures,
residential. And basically it doesn't really change anything, it just shifts everything down.
The red line comes from the fixed asset accounts?
It's come from the BEA accounts, yeah.
It's called the fixed asset.
Yes.
And it includes all the intangibles that they include.
They try, right? So that's another answer to that. They have tried to incorporate, but
the argument many have, like McGrathen and Prescott, is that they haven't included everything. Okay, so once you add
those things that they want to include, it's just not enough.
Okay.
So, okay, I'm only on puzzle number one here, so I need to,
and
I haven't even talked about the solutions. Okay, so puzzle number two, there seems to be, have been,
and you can either compute Tobin's Q.
So what's the Tobin's Q? Just the market value of installed capital over the replacement cost.
You can either compute it like Hall did in his 2001 paper.
I should have had the macro Q here as opposed to the micro one, since Bob is in the audience.
Or you can take, you know, from CompuStat.
And what you see, and there's a literature on this that suggests that the market value of installed capital over the replacement cost
So I guess, according to the neoclassical growth model, it should be 1.
Well, it's differing from 1. I suppose you shouldn't be too surprised about that.
I guess the puzzle here is just that that discrepancy has been increasing over time.
Okay, and I think that is relatively well-established. Well, I don't want to push too far, but that seems that people agree in the literature that there's something going on there.
Okay, and the puzzle then is that why has there not been more investment given that
the market value of capital is so high? Okay, so the puzzle here should be one in the long run in the neoclassical model.
It seems to be not only different from one, but gradually increasing.
Okay, with of course some variation,
you know, the 2001 crash and so on.
Okay, so that's number 2. Number 3, and in a sense, this was actually one of the things that gave rise to why we started thinking about this. This here shows you the return on capital computed by Domek, Ravi Kumar, and Rupert, and it shows you that it has essentially, and you can take this further back, it has essentially stayed constant over the past 30 years. Meanwhile, other measures have been showing a gradual decline, you know, the most notably the Treasury, so this is the real return adjusted for inflation.
You see it here that they have been gradually declining. So in other words, there seemed to be a spread forming in between the risk-free rate and the return on capital, or also other measures of capital, like corporate BAA or AAA,
okay, which presumably includes some sort of a risk premium. One way of stating that is there seems to be increased discrepancy between the average return on capital and the marginal return.
Okay?
Well, and that, of course, yeah, go ahead.
I mean, there's a risk premium, too.
So. But that should presumably be included here.
Oh, no, no.
Right?
You can measure, you can quantify bond risk. Bond risk is tiny.
Right. So you could, one explanation here could be that these do not measure fully the risk, and it's a bit higher. But I think it would be quite difficult, though, to generate
this. So what you will then need is that you need a gradual increase in risk premia over this period of time.
And that is a proposition some people have put forward, like Fari and Cavalier and others.
I mean, Gilchrist can tell you exactly what the bond risk numbers are. They're tiny.
Right. They are tiny, so that's the point here. But you want to have another line that includes more.
And my point is, measured correctly, since bonds hardly ever default, it's going to be a tiny change. And that means it all comes on the risk premium.
Right. So I we could have alternative measures of risk here, but I guess I would like to suggest, though, that
the evidence for a massive increase in risk premium over this time is
not that strong, and in any event, probably not strong enough to account for the full
increase in spread. But I give you that is one alternative hypothesis, and that's one that we should probably discuss once we start talking about the... we are actually going to have in the model also an endogenous increase in the risk premium, but it's going to be from different sources. Let's wait a little bit for that.
Okay, so the puzzle here, again, is that
there has been an increase in spread between average and marginal, and they should be one and the same in the neoclassical model.
Okay, so the fact that they're different, perhaps not so surprising. The fact that the difference is increasing over time, perhaps a bit more.
Okay, and of course a constant R, not a declining one, is one of Kaldor's stylized fact. That's how he made it into the title. Okay? So that's three puzzles, I guess. Increase in wealth, constant capital output, rise in Tobin's Q, increase in the discrepancy between average
and marginal.
And then finally, not finally, there's one more after number 4.
We have seen a decrease in both labor and capital share. We could have, of course, long arguments about how exactly we would measure these.
Okay. But I think most people, the literature seems to be agreeing on there has been a decline in both labor share.
And then, depending on how you measure, though, capital share, there seemed to be also some evidence for a decline there as well, giving rise to what Karbarabunis and Niemann say, an increase in factorless income. That is,
an increase in income you can either attribute to labor
or capital.
Okay. So, you know, of course, then the
fourth postulate is that these are should be constant in the neoclassical model, that's one of Kaldor's other stylized factors.
Finally, let me just put one series here up. You could put a lot of different investment series. The fifth puzzle, and that was also one of the things that really, that was one of the things we were trying to fix in the model when we had declining real rate, is that, you know, there's been a decrease in investment to output ratio, even if we have historically low borrowing cost and high Tobin skew. Okay? So those are the five things. To sum up, high wealth to output despite low KNY, high Tobin skew, and increasing over time,
decrease in R while measured return on capital appears to be constant,
a decrease in both labor share and capital share, rise in fabulous income, and then despite this low R and high Q, there is a decrease in investment to output.
How is 5 different from 4 in the sense that if the capital share is low, shouldn't investment be low?
It depends on the model, right?
I don't think it's totally obvious.
But I'm, you know, all of these puzzles are obviously related.
So, you know, you same with Q and puzzle 1 and 3, so I don't want to say, yeah, I mean,
they are related indeed. But I think you can probably come up with a model in which, you know, they could be kind of low investment and still capital share not decreasing. But okay, so the resolution or the hypothesis we're going to pursue here is that P1 to 5 are going to be driven by two underlying trends,
gradual increase in monopoly power in markups, and then a decline in the interest rate.
Okay? And the argument is going to be twofold. Well, one, qualitatively, and secondly, we're going to put it in a model, and we're going to see that it seems to do a reasonably good quantitative job at matching these numbers.
It's not the rate of interest that matters. The cost of capital for an investment is controlled by the risk of that investment. The interest rate is the risk-free rate. So you should say a decline in the natural rate of return on capital.
Yeah, I'm happy to do that.
Good.
And a decline in the natural return on
capital.
Yes, cost capital. Okay, so now why do we pick these features? You know, the real interest rate we have seen, the risk-free rate, so I'm not going to back off too much on that. So we see in the data
the risk-free rate has gone down.
Okay, so that's going to be... Now, why do we pick market power?
I guess I don't really need to explain that here. The whole conference is about that and the literature that has emerged over the past few years that is supportive of that. So, you know, in the paper, we document
some of the measures that the literature has constructed and we
reconstruct.
I suppose there are the
concentration measures, revenue shares of larger firms.
I guess this is one that I find somewhat interesting
because we are working, and I won't be able to show you those results here, but we're working on extension, which is related to the paper we saw this morning, where we are in fact trying to calibrate the rising market, disciplining it with increase, there was an increase in entry and then a decline. And I think one might also want to ask,
what's driving it? One of the things that I think is somewhat interesting
is that you can look actually at demographics that seem to have
similar patterns. But I mean, that's sort of just advertising of
work that may or may not show up in the future.
Okay. So let me skip these because these are discussions that I would typically have,
when I give this paper elsewhere where people may not be as familiar
with the
work on markups.
So this is just to say, you know, there's been a large
amount of literature on each of these puzzles, diving into the data and alternative explanations.
So here are the ideas to try to give a simple, unified
explanation for them.
Okay, so let me then show you, so we're going to try to just do minor tweaks to the neoclassical growth model to
capture
these five facts. So let me just show you what those tweaks are. Okay. So we are going to be interested in matching the asset price facts,
like the risk premia. Okay, so we are going to...
So you can do that in multiple ways, of course.
The literature has found. The one we picked,
just because it seemed the most fashionable at the moment, was to have Epstein's in preferences and long-term
risk. And, you know, I'm going to show you in a minute.
Okay, so we started actually with an OLG model, but then we moved to this. The OLG model was aimed at explaining the decline of the real interest rate. Here we're going to take a shortcut. And the way in which interest rate will be declining is just
going to be by this fudge factor here. Okay, there's going to be a shift in this dt.
Okay, and you know the steady state real interest rate is going to be related one-to-one to this dt. And that's going to be what we're going to twist so as to generate a drop in real interest rate.
I would like you perhaps to keep in mind something like demographics underlying the shift that generates the drop. This is going to be a representative household.
Okay, so what are we going to do? We're going to do something very basic. We're just going to introduce
final good and intermediate good firms. And the final good firms, they are going to be, they're both going to be paying dividends.
The final good firms, they are going to be entering. There's going to be entry and there's going to be exit. But they are going to have monopoly power. Okay?
So we're going to have Dixit, Stiglitz preferences for these guys. And that's going to generate markup. Okay? And then we're going to imagine that markup is increasing over time. Okay, so the dividend payments of each of these firms are going to be capitalized, okay?
And that's going to be the price then of the shares in each of these firms, and that's what's going to give rise to the fact that
we can have wealth increasing over time.
Now, so why do we have exit and entry here? Well, you sort of need it if you want to have a very low
interest rate if you don't want the claims here on the final good firms to explode.
In particular, if you go to negative rates, well, you better have them.
Okay, unless you have so much risk that it gets priced.
So this becomes helpful in order to calibrate the model. Okay, so the final good composite is
just going to be a standard Dixit Stiglitz, implying, and the final good is going to use the intermediate input
as a factor of production, okay?
And the final good producers
are then going to be facing a standard Dixit Stiglitz demand curve.
So, you know, the markup is just going to be given then
by, as usual, the elasticity of substitution across the final goods.
Okay, so the uncertainty in the model then is going to be, D here.
And it's going to be, wrong direction.
And it's going to be also variations in this markup. Okay, and there's going to be a gradual increase in this markup that we're going to be considering.
So the important assumption here is that there is going to be entry and exit is purely exogenous. That's the thing that we're kind of working on endogenizing
right now.
So, you know, that's going to be generating pure profits, and that's the key difference between the classical model.
There are going to be these pure profits
that are going to contribute then to asset
prices and wealth creation in a way that may be different from the accumulation of fiscal capital.
Okay, so the bears are not permanent just because,
but it's all exogenous, so I should probably not spend too much time on this. Okay, and the asset pricing then is going to be,
well, the final good firm is going to be the net present value of dividends taking into account their exogenous exit. For entering firm, the shares are going to just be distributed to individuals as IPO securities. The representative firm and the intermediate good side,
this is where capital enters, they're going to have a CES production function, and then they're going to have adjustment costs like in German, and you know this part of the model is completely standard. Okay, so we are going to have then, so remember we had Epstein's in preferences,
and then we're going to have long-run productivity risk entering into our model
as is standard in this macrofinance literature, with the productivity having some long-run persistent components, and that's going to be very useful to generate a equity premium. Okay, we're going to want the model of equity premium because, you know, as you recall, some of these facts had to do with asset pricing. Okay, so wealth and Tobin's Q. So the wealth here is then going to be the sum here of the final good and the intermediate goods firms, the price of their stocks. So you can see here immediately how the first puzzle get resolved. I'll talk a little bit more about it in a second. Okay, so there's going to be a wedge between wealth and capital. Okay, so that was a brief sketch of the model. Okay, you go ahead.
What's the coefficient of relative risk?
I'll show you in a second. I don't remember the top of my head. I think we used the one that these guys here had in order to, yeah. So I mean the skeletons in their closet
immigrated into our closet too.
But they're there.
They're there. Okay. They are there. They're there.
Don't keep it secret.
No, no. So that's important only to explain the equity premium, right? So yeah. Let me talk here about the qualitative resolution of the model, okay? And let me talk about that qualitative resolution within just the steady state of the model so that it's not going to capture any of the asset price feature and you know, the relative risk aversion is only going to be relevant for the steady state real interest rate, which is also governed by this D, okay? So let's talk a little bit about the qualitative resolution of
the five puzzles in the model.
So consider here a steady state, and I'm here going to specialize just in a Cobb-Douglas production function. Okay, so I'm not going to be really able to here talk about the evolution of some financial variables that include risk premia that we will need the full stochastic simulation to try to understand. Okay, so how much? So the first thing, as you recall, was the rise in wealth over output while capital output stayed constant. And here, you know, this resolution of that is relatively straightforward qualitatively. So, you know, now wealth is composed not just of XI, but also these final good producers that are monopolistically competitive. And here's just the formulas for that over output. And you can see directly that it increases with mu, remember, which is the markup, and also, in fact, via reduction in the real interest rate. Okay, turns out you sort of need both. Meanwhile, here, the increase in mu would lead to an increase in capital, will lead to a reduction in the capital output ratio. And there you can see that you need the R decline to sort of offset that.
So these two things, this is going to be true in a lot of the puzzles.
The increase in monthly permanent reduction in R is sort of important to balance these forces. They tend to work, they sometimes work in the opposite direction. Okay, so that was number one. Number two was the increase in there's a typo here, this should be Y in this K. So here, this is sort of similar that you have here, you have here that increase in markups are going to generate increase in the value of the firm without necessarily correspondingly increase in
their investment in their capital. They're just charging larger markups.
So that can also rationalize this gradual increase in Q. The declining interest rate has ambiguous effect, though, on Q here. Okay. Puzzle number three, as you recall, that was that the average return was constant while these measures of marginal return appeared to be declining. And, you know, keeping in mind Bob's Hall caveat, there might be another line here that has slightly higher risk premium, but I think that reasonable risk premium will still imply an increasing wedge. So here you can see that a decline in R, like we've seen in the data, should lead to that's this piece here, that should lead simultaneously to a decline in the average return. But there the markups will offset it, so an increase in markup increases average return,
Exactly, then, the two forces can then offset each other, leading to constant average return, while R is declining. So this is a natural, so yet again, these forces are playing against each other. P4, decline in capital and labor shear, here are just the formulas, they're relatively straightforward. In each case, it's just an increase in mu, just increases the factor less income, leading then to a reduction in both of the capital and the labor share. Finally, so that seems straightforward too. Finally, there is a decline in investment, and here is the formula. So to your question, you know, are they, they're not exactly the same, so at least not quantitatively. I mean, it's not like the formula, the quantitative implications do not exactly need to coincide. Here you see, you know, an increase in markups also leads in sort of a wedge to the marginal return of capital and investment given here by mu. Okay, so what these formulas were supposed to convey is that qualitatively, all of these five features of the data, these broad movements, could in principle, go ahead.
Yeah. Well, I was going to say, you're getting this through this sort of mechanical thing where you're changing demand to be more product appreciation. If you introduce the market power more on the technology side, like this morning what Jan was doing, and have more skewed distribution of marginal costs, would you be able to run all five things and get the same?
No, I think that's the interesting question. I guess we take a relatively unambitious stance here of just putting in these exogenous forcing variables. And remember why we are allowed to have them exogenous was,
well, it's because in the case of real interest rate, it was just this factor here. In the case of the markups, it's just the elasticity of
substitution. Of course, then you might want to try to model these in more detail and see if there's even an interplay between the two. And I think that's the obvious next step. And, you know, I think it's something we're actually thinking about. But, you know, that's a fair criticism here. I mean, clearly, this is very reduced form. What I just want to convince you of now is that, you know, you need something that would show up, like these, we can call them wedges, in order to, or I can, what I want to claim is that these kind of wedges can account for the data. And then, of course, we want to maybe have a deeper story for where they come from. Ideally, we would want one force that, you know, moves both of these wedges in the same way. And, you know, we haven't quite, I have a couple of candidates in mind, but we have certainly not gotten there yet. Okay, other comments? Okay, so what I want to ask first, sort of by putting numbers on the formulas I just showed you,
I wanted to, because before, you know, once you use simulated method of moments on the larger model, it's sort of easy to, it's kind of, at least for me, hard to figure out what's going on, so I want to do something a little bit simpler first.
Okay, so, because, you know, you saw the steady state formulas, why don't we just try to put numbers on those and see how far we can get, understanding that we're going to be off on the financial variables
because we have no risk in steady state.
Okay, so this is what I did. So this here is the wealth to output ratio in 1970.
This is the labor shear. This is investment to output. Okay, so I'm going to pick here, and these here are my priors on what I believe these here, what the parameters I'm going to be picking are. Okay, I have some information on depreciation. I have some information on the exit rates. And I have information on the shear production function. I stick those information into distribution here. And then I just maximize this objective function.
Okay, so let me first maximize this objective function to hit as well as I can. These are, and remember, these are three of the three elements of the puzzles. Okay? So, you know, wealth to output, labor share, investment to output, average return in Q, and I'm not going to be matching these because these are financial variables where I would want to take into account risk.
Okay, so this here is the result of this maximization, and this here are these ratios in 1970
in the bracket, and this is what the model gives me. Okay, and I can see, I'm going to show you in a minute what the parameters that generate this, and you can see here that, you know, I pretty much hit them
exactly and don't do too badly here even on Q and average return,
except for the average return, of course, in the steady state are going to be lower than in the data, given that there's no risk. Okay? So then the thought experiment, remember, I just want to put simple, parameterize the steady state relationship to see if these two, let's just call them wedges, generate what I want. And this here is sort of my reading of the, Jan will have to forgive me, if my reading of,
if I want to parameterize a macro model, what the literature is saying about
the increase in markups is sort of relatively modest, from 3 to 2, the real interest rate. And this is then what I get for, and I'm comparing here 1970 to 2015. And you can see that just, you know, feeding in these wedges into the steady state relationship, I'm roughly getting here what you see in the data. So again, this is the data. This here is what the model is saying. Okay? So I pinned down 1970, feed it in the two forcing variables, and this is what it spit out. Okay, so I was just comparing the end of the time series, right? So it's not exactly the strongest econometric test you can think of, but I'm just getting a sense of the rough magnitudes, okay? So you can see that you're sort of getting these four things. Let me then show you what are the, you know, the result of this maximization problem. This is the depreciation.
This is the coefficient in the Cobb-Douglas function. And this here is the exit rate, and that seems pretty big. Okay, 0.21, that seemed pretty big for exit rates, okay?
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
So the last two that you cannot match, so is this something because the model is unable to match the error, or can you, suppose you were going to choose something?
I didn't match it because I didn't try, right? I picked these to match these three, and I didn't want to, so the reason I didn't want to match the average return in Q is because I'm doing a simple steady state here where, you know, I don't take risk into account. In the quantitative evaluation, a couple of slides, there I do a stochastic simulation, there I could hope to match these. So I sort of just picked these. Now, why did I choose these parameters? Well, sort of an illustration, okay? So, and I think it's informative, A, because you can see with sort of parameters that looks reasonable, you get something
that looks in the data. And B, this here is too big, and
these here are a bit too small, which helps you understand why, in fact, when I do the stochastic simulation, I'm able to get a much smaller number here that is more consistent with what you have in the data, and in fact match the asset prices implications. Okay, so what I think we learned from this is that for reasonable parameters here, so these were all in closed form, you can sort of match this puzzle
that perhaps gives you a little bit more faith in what I'm going to show you here, where I'm going to do a second order expansion of the model, do the same type of calibration exercise, except I need to do then simulate the method of moments, and I'm going to have stochastic markups and productivity is going to be stochastic. Did you have a question? Okay.
But it's essentially going to be in exactly the same spirit. I'm going to pick now more parameters. I'm going to try to also match the asset price implication. I'm going to pick the parameters in order to match the data in 1970, like these key moments in the 1970s of the five puzzles. Then, you know, keeping everything constant, I'm going to feed in a change in average markup, a reduction in the real interest rate. And how is the reduction in the real interest rate generated? Two ways. There's going to be a decline in productivity as observed in the data, and then the rest of the decline is being generated by this D, if you recall, in the preference. And then we're going to ask, okay, how well does the model do? Okay? Okay, so this is just what I said, 5 minutes. These are sort of estimates in the literature. This is why I picked in the previous slide, 1.1 to 1.22. And I should say what we do in the paper, we take, so this is Hall, in the paper I think he's going to give tomorrow. We look at Nakarja Ramey, Barkai, and Locker. So we're able to pretty much get the five puzzles with these three estimates. If we do put in these numbers, though, we, you know, it doesn't work. Okay, sorry, we haven't tried to do the adjustments. I'll need to consult you with what exact number you want to put in there.
You're using numbers from underestimated at the firm or industry level.
Right, yeah, no.
Computing them without any further adjustment to the whole economy.
I'm not claiming that. This is just trying to give you, yeah, so.
What I will say is this. What we're working on is to come up with our own estimate that are better in sync with the model we're using, okay? This is sort of a rough using.
What we did for now is not overly ambitious. We just took out from what people have been estimating these horizon markets to be, and yeah, it's true. That's from different.
This is macro level. This is also macro level. So maybe those are the most natural one for us to use, which is pretty close to what we actually use. So taking it from industry estimate, yeah, I agree. It may not be the most sensible. I mean, BarkEye is from macro data. Now, that has other issues to it, so
fine. Okay, so this is, yeah, so this is these are estimates from of the decline in interest rates. These are the values we assume, so I'm hoping I'll find here the elasticity of the relative coefficient of relative risk aversion, but it's not here. So from memory, it's 6 or 7, but you know, I need to check.
We took basically from Croce and.
Okay. All right. So these are the target that we try to hit now. So we are now trying to hit the equity premium. Okay. These are the parameters. I'm sorry, I just have 2 or 3 minutes left.
So I'm just going to flip through this, and I want to make one more point that it's not dependent on
this. So we choose 1970. We don't pick the parameters. The structure match anything is 2015, and then our level of success or failure is then the degree to which our model can capture the changes in the data. You know that we associate with the puzzles. And the bottom line is that they seem to capture them relatively well. Whereby relatively well, I mean the age-old eyeball exam. Okay, so the what I wanted to say, so then in the paper we look at, you need really both. If you just do decline real interest and just markups, you don't really hit these five facts or puzzles. What I want to end with is, because I'm out of time, and I'm just going to speed through this. So this is the locker out, that doesn't quite work. I wanted to sort of talk a little bit about, well, why did you pick 1970 or 1980? Why didn't you go further? This was actually a comment that came up at the EFG that Bob may recall. So what I just want to point out to you is that there is this sort of inverse U-shape of all of the variables. So this is Tobin's Q. This is, well, the return on capital is a little bit, but you know, there's sort of the real rate were low in the 60s and 70s, 1 minute. And the bottom line, what I want to tell you is that, and then if you look at markups, some measures, they also seem to have this relationship. Okay, so this was, I guess, Carl Barbunis was trying to argue that this was reflecting some failure of the model, but if you would have looked a little harder, well, then the prediction of the model is you should have the inverse of the poor puzzles going from here to here. Okay, and that's precisely what you actually do see, and the model can, in fact, capture that. So in other words, if you go backwards in time, again, matching to 1970, but then feeding in, you know, the numbers going backwards, you seem to also capture, you know, the period pre as well. Anyway, so I'm out of time. So the pre story seems to be consistent with moderate level of markup in 1960, followed by decline until 1980, followed by a significant increase. So that's sort of the bottom line. It's not in the paper, it's something we're working on. But I think the period pre-1970s and 80s is actually consistent with, okay. Let me just end here. So I don't have anything to say about policy here, precisely for the reason you said. I mean, it's reduced form. Presumably, you know,
is this rise in markup
some malignant development, and you need antitrust? Not obvious. I mean, there's nothing. I think it's way too early to say. Okay, that's it.